So this afternoon we have a very interesting session with three speakers, and each one has 30 minutes, and they have at least 25 minutes to present because there's a lot of material, and I don't want to waste their time. And so just wanted to introduce myself. My name is Orna Intrapor. I work at the University of Rochester. I'm a professor there for health, for public health sciences, and I'm also at the VA. I am at the VA in Canandaigua, New York, but I direct the Geriatric Extended Care Data Analysis Center, which I created 12 years ago, which is funded by the central office. So I deal with a lot of data, all the VA data, a lot of Medicare data, et cetera, and do a lot of evaluations. And I've been working with Eric Stoller here, for example, 10 years ago there. And enough about me. It's time to introduce our first speaker, and he is also the our host. So Igor Akushevich will talk about analytical methods for that explanation of disparities in Alzheimer's disease and related dementias.
Thank you. So, I will tell you about analytic methods for explaining cells disability and disabilities in related dementia. So, we know that burden associated with Alzheimer's disease and related dementia is not equally distributed across the United States. And therefore, an important aspect of this growing problem are the symptoms, race, and sex, and geographic disparity in Alzheimer's disease and related dementia. We will discuss analytic methods capable of explaining this disability in terms of predictors. We will use Medicare data as a main data set for which we will illustrate our methods. So let's first understand how to measure disparities. We can use Medicare data and calculate prevalence proportion. Mortality, actually this is incidence-based mortality related to Alzheimer's disease and related dementia, and the incidence rate. You see in all cases, estimates for black are higher, even much higher in cases. So this is estimates for survival, race-specific survival. It's a little difficult to say for which race survival is better. So let's let's estimate the hazard ratios. This is a hazard ratio for incidence and survival. This is incidence. Let's pay specific attention for black versus white. All estimates are versus white. And this is incidence. And this is survival. We see that we have higher incidence for black subpopulation, and in contrast, lower mortality. This is survival for black population. So now we can estimate the geographic disparity. This is incidence rate by United States. So we see an important region like Stroh Belt region and NASM in Washington state. We know that mortality from Alzheimer based on the death certificate is much higher in Washington state, but not in the case of incidence and incidence-based mortality. And we use Medicare data. So for geographic disparity, we can assume that this is because of population heterogeneity. But not. We calculated hazard rate stroke growth versus no stroke bell for population group and see that we still have much higher rates for stroke belt regions. The estimates of different type disparity and user model also demonstrate that higher incidence corresponds to better survival. So now, this is just how to measure and what we have to explain. Let's try to explain. First, we need to understand what does it mean to explain disparities in terms of covariance. A health disparity is measured as a difference of two rates. And to explain this difference means to have this decomposition, where each factor is associated with certain predictor. And we would like to have an answer like this. This factor explains, say, 30% of disparity. This factor explains 15% of disparity. This factor explains 10% of disparity, etc. That's what we would like to have. We need to develop methods to have this type of decomposition. If we have this decomposition, we can speak, we can, for example, develop public health intervention for modifiable risk factor, maybe to think about development of new technology for part or not. So let's start with rate decomposition. Methodologists and statisticians believe that they know how to decompose rate and explain rate in terms of predictors. For example, the Lancet Commission recently reported that modifiable risk factors can explain up to 40% of demand share cases with specific predictors like less education explains 7%, hearing loss in midlife is responsible for 8%, smoking for 5%, and so on, etc. How we can do it methodologically? If we have all data, all information collected in one data set, we can simply define a regression equation. This is our outcome anytime. This is our predictors. Using a sample from our data set, we can estimate this regression. Then we can average this regression. And as a result, we get the decomposition of average outcome in terms of predictors associated with specific risk factors. This is how the task for a decomposition can be solved if we have all information in one data set. So now let's come back to the task of the disparity instead. And unfortunately, the rate decomposition methods we just discussed do not work for decomposition of disparities. And my main problem is that in contrast to the rates, there are no one specific regression model that can represent disparity in terms of predictor using individual data. Because in one regression, we need to have simultaneously black and white. For example, if we consider black-white disparities, it's not possible to estimate such regression using individual data. Instead, we need to do something. We can, for example, to estimate the regression for both subpopulations and combine then somehow or develop and develop an appropriate statistical model. Let's see which properties of this model should be, at least what we should expect on the properties of this model. First of all, such model should be applicable for time to event data. We would like to work with cohorts. We would like to work with Medicare data. Therefore, we have to develop models applicable for time to event data. Then, I think that the requirements for accuracy should be much higher for analysis of disparities compared to analysis of rate. This is because we consider difference between two rates, that rates could be large and difference could be not so large. And in this situation, different biases and different insufficient statistical power play more important role. And the same argument suggests that we need to use high powerful data, and also it's reasonable to use different type of statistical methodologies, in order to compare our estimates. So now we will use two cohorts for our illustration. One of them is baseline age at 67 and 15 years of follow-up, and another one baseline age at 75 and 10 years of follow-up. Outcome is over Alzheimer's disease onset, and our main predictor is socioeconomic status represented by a fraction of months in the follow-up period with dual eligibility. This is a time-independent predictor. And also we will have eight diseases measured at baseline and annually updated during follow-up period. These diseases are listed here. We see that this is disease risk related in respect to Alzheimer's disease. So now, traditional approach is based on a sequence of Fox model. So, and the predictor is said to explain some portion of health disparity if the effect associated with the disparity affected group, yeah, for example, demographic disparity or black-white disparity, is significantly reduced when the predictor of interest is added to the Fox model. For example, if let's assume that we have a hazard ratio 1.6 in univariate analysis with Alzheimer's disease risk with one covariate like risk decay. Then we can add, for example, socioeconomic status, and after that, the effect of race goes from 1.6 to 1.6. In this case, we can conclude that CES explains 50% of black-white disparity on the risk of Alzheimer's disease. So there are some arguments underlying such method, but there is no good or rigorous mathematical proof of this. And it was shown in the literature that estimates obtained using this approach cannot be causally interpreted. We will discuss why, but let me say that this is because of different baseline hazard corresponding to model with different predictors. So now we applied this traditional approach to our cohort. This is the cohort one. Yeah. We considered unidimensional analysis of race. This is all hazard ratio. This is effect of black versus white. So we considered bivariate models. We considered models with three predictors and even four. This one says race and stroke, for example, here. We performed this mass production, but we were not able to rank effect after socioeconomic status, contributing and explaining these disparities. It's quite difficult to say something. This is, we consider disease at baseline only, and diseases as time-dependent. No clear picture. Then we use the same analysis for second couple. And conclusion is the same. The results confirm that socioeconomic status is an important predictor capable of explaining health disparity in Alzheimer's disease risk. But we cannot say anything about other predictors, about their rank, about relative contribution, like 5, 4, 6, 10%, becomes. So why we don't have a clear conclusion? Main reason is because of different baseline hazard in models with different set of predictors. When we estimate costs, we don't estimate baseline. If we estimate costs with different predictors, baseline will be different. And it means that difference in rate estimated in this way does not result in difference in hazard ratio. And this produces a mess, actually. And another cause is that we have order dependence. If to use first predictor and then second, or second and then first, we will have different results. And also uncertainty also cannot be clearly combined. So, and we can confirm this conclusion. But let me make important statement that even if we had a method, a regression-based approach for explaining disparities in such a way, it would be insufficient because this is only a part effect can be explained in this way, so-called vulnerability. Because vulnerability effect is associated with beta, with our regression coefficient. But disparity can be generated using different prevalence of risk factor in subpopulation. And this effect cannot be captured within the traditional methods. Let's discuss a little bit in details what I mean. There are two different effects we have to estimate. One of them, this is exponent. Disparity can be generated because of difference in prevalence of a predictor in two populations and vulnerability. A disparity can be generated because of difference in the effect of predictor in population with this predictor. This is example. Alzheimer disease can be high in black cell population because, first, prevalence of hypertension, this is AP risk factor, is higher in black population. This is exposure. And also can be higher risk of Alzheimer among individuals with hypertension. This is a response the better estimated in traditional methods. And the successful methods have to capture both, I think. Let's go to examples. Power union regression decomposition technique. This is the formula the authors obtained. And this is this approach, we can estimate two effects, vulnerability and exposure for each predictor. And we have this sum that is obtained under certain methodological assumptions. We applied this approach to our cohorts one, cohort two, and we found that socioeconomic status is still important, but hypertension may be even more important. And in hypertension, we have vulnerability effect. It's important in socioeconomic status. We have exposure effect. It's important, and vulnerability is even negative. We can have negative effect. It means that respective effect generate higher rate in white than in black. For example, depression. Depression have even total effect negative. And third effect, I would say, after assessing hypertension, this is effect of stroke. This is good method, but we have to understand, we have to analyze and understand methodological assumptions made for this method. So now, another approach, population attributable fraction. So this is definition of population reduction in the population disease incidence or mortality that would occur if exposure to a risk factor was zero. Very popular approach. For example, a conclusion about 40% we just discussed was made using this kind of approach. This is for AIDS, but we can generalize this for disparities to define this as the proportional reduction in disparity that would occur if exposure to a given risk factor reduces to zero. How to derive this? We can have multivariate proportional Fox model with CS and 8 diseases, and we can estimate this model and then apply averaging. leveraging combined predictors can be performed analytically, and as a result, we have total bar in this quite famous formula. This is the decomposition. Path corresponding to specific spark. This is definition. And this is how people from Lancet Commission make a conclusion about 40%. They didn't have all data in the same data set and applied extra method, but idea is this. So now we can try to generalize this approach for disparities and just add a race indicator and beta to the model. And we can calculate the disparity using this model, and we see this formula. Then this factor constant can be absorbed by baseline hazard, and we have decomposition for disparities identical to decomposition of rain. Roughly, this is because everything is proportional in this one. That's why we have a decomposition for disparities. Very similarly, like decomposition of rain. We can apply our cohort and see similar results. Says and hypertension are most important predictor, stroke is third, and also depression is important predictor. This method can't capture sign in this case. So now let's discuss the rank replace. Yes, this is a series of approaches with main idea to replace something. For example, in data, replace some variables between white and black subpopulation, or replace some parameter estimates. We will consider two popular approaches, model of Rao. In this case, we have separate model estimates for white and black, and use parameter estimates from white to predict the rates in black. And also Institute of Medicine model, this is pooled model, and they replace individual linear predictor, for example, for disease. They ranked individuals by percentiles and replace predictor from white to black population. What we have? This is details. Best model, Rao model. We have two regressions, different betas, and replace this beta to this beta. So, and we see that observed disparity essentially reduced, yeah, in both cohorts. It means large, we have detected large vulnerability effect of diseases. Why vulnerability? Because we replaced back. This is responsible for vulnerability. And the remaining effect is due to different sets, disease specific exposure effect, and unexplained part because of the consent. Second model, just one model with the same beta, except of intercept, and we replace linear predictor. It means we detected exposure effect in this case. No vulnerability. It's not possible to get vulnerability effect using this model because we have pooled regression. The same beta in both subpopulations. And as a result, we don't have any difference and even negative effect. Very small negative exposure effect due to diseases. Now, parametric. To me, this is some extension of previous approach. But here we equalize everything except of something. For example, we simulate we carefully simulate two subpopulations, natural course and counterfactual population. And in counterfactual population, we change something. For example, we can equalize distribution of social economic status in between black and white subgroup and simulate two populations and estimate racial disparities in both simulated population, and difference gives us a causal effect of CS on this racial disparity. This is technical steps we need to make. And this is the results of our for our two cohorts. We have CSTPX, this is causal estimates, 56% to 67%. Before we discuss our conclusion, let me show you three methods we developed in our group. This first one, polar decomposition, is a method for representing cause of death contribution to disparity in life experience. In our recent paper, we solved the polar integral, resulting in an analytical expression for two types of data, MCT and Medicare. We end by avoiding any use of numeric integration. Next one, partitioning analysis, is designed to explain trends for disparities in disease prevalence and mortality in terms of disease incidence, survival, and other like this. Again, it works for Medicare and registry data. Then stochastic process model. It provides dynamic of covariate linked to hazard rate under reasonable assumption. Important property of this model is that it's possible to get analytical average of a sample for all population with clear opportunity to represent vulnerability and exposure effect for disparities. Let me move to my conclusion. We developed and applied a series of approaches capable of explaining health disparities in terms of covariance, including traditional methods and others. We found that racial disparities demonstrated importance that social economic factors as an important predictor. These also affect cognitive effect of risk-related diseases. First of all, arterial hypertension was the most important predictor among disease-specific predictors of racial disparities. And this is my methodological conclusion. Estimates were consistent across different models, but not identical. Pavel's Yan approach and approach involving population attributable fraction are most promising. Parametric G formula has potential for causal estimates. However, future analytic work have to complete it to analyze why we have different estimates for the same data set. We need to analyze biases, we need to analyze assumptions and clarify this. Traditional methods, we discussed this, does not open up a clear conclusion, especially for multiple partners. Successful method has to provide both contribution like exposure and vulnerability, as we discussed. Accuracy required for evaluation of effect on health disparities should be higher than for decomposition of RAIN, and different and multiple approaches have to apply for cross-check. And finally, I would like to say that Medicare data is appropriate data set for analyzing disparities in ADAD and three interacting direction, multi-ethnic, sex structure, population, place of residence, and maybe even time period. Thank you.
Wow. We have time for one question.
In your multiple runs, do you use the run you believe the best, or do you average the runs, sort of the ensemble type average of your output?
Average. You mean average?
But if you suppose you fit two or three models,
mm-hmm.
Okay, and they have a predicted value.
Mm-hmm.
It seems to be, at least my experience has been, that if you have two or three viable models and you take their average prediction, it's more stable than any of the three. I was wondering if you...
I would say that we can have a picture of all these models.
Right.
Then we understand why they are different. Yeah, one of the models have linear assumptions in hazard ratio. Another one has certain linear. We can use simulation studies to better understand. I would like to say that it's possible to make this analytical work to completely clarify this, and even maybe to reduce each other with these corrections.